So good morning all of you. I hope I'm audible and visible. Please give me a quick thumbs up, all my dear students, Shruti, Praveen, Meghna, all of you give me a quick thumbs up if my audio video is fine. Chalo. So let's begin with the today's session, and before the others join, we will have a quick discussions of the important batches which has started recently or about to start or already started. So I request all my dear friends to please be with me for the next 30 minutes. This will be a very important session. Praveen, just wait for some more time for the session to begin. So all of you, welcome to this must know questions in dermatology. You all are on the best online platform for the preparation of NEET PG, that is an academy. And I'm Dr. Cheshta Agarwal, your NEET PG educator on this amazing platform. Now you also have, or you do have, a lot of special classes of all the different subjects taken up by all the educators associated with an academy. These are free live classes, and you are right now in one of the free special class, that is an academy. The free special class of 30 minutes. I do take two sessions every day, one at 11 a.m. and another is at 2 p.m. Other than this, if you like these classes, we also give you paid subscriptions, that is plus, which give you an access to an academy, live classes, including the quizzes, test series, vast question bank, and printed notes. And second is the iconic subscription, which give you an access to both an academy and prep ladder. Prep ladder has an added advantage of question banks, video lectures, and clinical essentials, along with the treasure notes or dream notes. In addition to this, the iconic subscription or the combo pack gives you study planners, study material, expert guidelines, test analysis, and personal guidance. So I request all my students, those who are planning for the next year exam, please go ahead with iconic. We are going on with some amazing offers, which I will be discussing very, very soon. Now, the batches which are starting today are the FMG batch course for December FMG, the second year professional batch course for the MBBS students. We have target next batch for 2023 preparation, and we have a NEET PG ultra fast track high yield topic revision batch. Now, we have recently updated our question bank with more than 25,000 questions. Those who are plus students can easily access this question, not available for free without any subscription. We have launched a 1 month subscription worth rupees 4500. It is actually 5000 rupees, but if you take a code, that is Cheshta10, you will get additional 10% discount, and you will get the same thing in 4500. Now I would request all of you to please go ahead with this, because the 1 month package includes ultra fast high yield revision batch for your upcoming NEET PG, emergency room MCQ discussion, NEET PG TND batch, last 3 year NEET PG PYQs, COVID test, and grand test. I request all my dear students to please be a part of this 1 month package. We have seen a lot of you already taken the subscriptions, and we have a sudden increase in the subscription. Those who have yet not taken the subscription, please go ahead and access these classes. We have a lot of grand tests scheduled for this month and the next month before your NEET PG entrance examination. For those who will be giving exam next year, we have a 12+2 offer. You buy a 12-month subscription, 2 months is free. And a 4-year subscription, if you buy a 60, if you buy plus, it would be 60,000, and iconic, it would be 75,000 rupees. And in the end, this is the price list. Whatever you want to take, please use my code in the end, that is Cheshta10. 1 month would be enough for NEET PG. 2 month, 3 month for FMG, and 1 year of either plus or 1 year of iconic would be best for your next pattern examination. So let's begin with the today's class. Please give me a quick thumbs up if everyone is ready for the first question. Ready, all of you? Amazing. Now please read this question. A 4-year-old girl was evaluated 2 weeks ago for a rash in the diaper area. Now again, the patient was found to have erythematous papule in the diaper area that spared the skin fold. Her symptom involved with the use of petroleum barrier ointment with every diaper change. Which of the following is the reason for development of the condition given in this patient? So which of the following is contributed to the patient's prior condition? First of all, tell me what is the diagnosis here. What is diagnosis given in the question? Anybody can tell me? Tashneem, Praveen, Raj, Farah, Anybody can tell me what is the diagnosis? Shrijit, Shruti, Manish. What is the diagnosis? Please remember, it is a case of diaper dermatitis, not candida lentigo. Diaper dermatitis. Now, why it is not candida lentigo? The reason is, the question says that the disease is improving with use of petroleum barrier ointment. Will petroleum barrier ointment improve candidal infection? The answer is a big no. If you use petroleum jelly in a candida infection, you are actually retaining the moisture. And if you are retaining the moisture, in a way, you are precipitating the fungal infection. So that is one thing. And obviously, they are mentioning that on the diaper areas, you are having the infection. So this becomes a case of diaper dermatitis. Please give me a thumbs up if this is clear to all of you. Give me a thumbs up. And another point, yes, they have written that there is sparing of the fold. So that is also in favor of diaper dermatitis and against the diagnosis of candida lentigo. Now, what actually happens, as I've told you before also, in diaper dermatitis, because of constant contact of the skin with either the urine or the stool, you have alteration of the pH and activation of the proteolytic enzyme, giving rise to eczematous lesions. And we have a diagrammatic picture here. So please look at this image. Those who are having the confusion, I think few days back we have discussed about the intertrigo and the diaper dermatitis. So the folds are spared in a patient of diaper dermatitis. Only the convex part are involved, while in intertrigo, the appearance is exactly opposite. So please give me a thumbs up if you understood the reason for irritant diaper dermatitis, because of constant close proximity of the skin with the ammonia or the urea containing stool and feces, which causes activation of the proteolytic enzyme. Everyone give me a thumbs up if this question is clear. So the correct answer becomes option number 2. Okay, chalo. Let's move to the next question. I hope everyone is ready. The next question is on your computer screen. Now, please read the question very, very carefully. A 14-month-old girl was brought to the clinic by her parents due to soreness on her feet. Since she took her first step 3 months ago, she has had blisters involving sole of the feet, which subsequently break down and heal very slowly. Examination shows small bullae at the sole with faint erythema and no scarring. Biopsy taken at the margin shows intraepidermal cleavage. Which of the following will contribute most likely in this patient's condition? Anyone can tell me the answer for this? So we have only 29%, Tasneem, Shashank, Sachi, Meghna. What about the remaining students? Anybody who are attending my class since a long time, I have discussed this point. Amazing. So I can see that there are many, many students who have started preparing, and I can see that the strength of the special classes have gone down. So previously we used to have like a lot of students live in the special class, but as the exams are approaching, I can see that students are more focused towards the plus classes. So that is very nice from your point. Whatever you feel like, whatever is your own strategy, please try to follow it, because at this point of time, you cannot waste time. Please plan yourself and give your time wherever required. Chalo, and few are lost because the notification came late. So anyways, chalo Ria, at least you were on time. This is the second question for those who have joined just now. This is the second question. Can you tell me what is the diagnosis here? Anyone? What is the diagnosis here? Quickly. What is the diagnosis here? Siddharth, Umam, Herald, Shabana, yes, absolutely right, Dr. Grace. The diagnosis here is mechanobullous disorder. And can you elaborate it more, Dr. Grace? Which type of mechanobullous disorder we are dealing with? What type of mechanobullous disorder we are dealing with? We are dealing with epidermolysis bullosa simplex. epidermolysis bullosa simplex. We have three type of mechanobullous disorder: EB simplex, EB junctional, and EB dystrophic. But here it is EB simplex. Why? Because in EB junctional and dystrophic, you will see the symptoms soon after birth. The mother will give you a history that as soon as she holds the baby, she can observe the skin coming out or peeling of the skin. That is how a patient of junctional and dystrophic presents. You are right, Dr. Grace. In dystrophic, scarring is very common. Although in junctional, scarring is not that common. But you see scarring when you go more and more deeper. Now, in this question, it is told that patient develops the bulla when she starts to walk. And she started walking around 12 months or 13 months of her age, like 3 months before she started to walk. Now, when she started to walk, there is trauma to the skin, and EB simplex classically presents because of this microtrauma. But my question is, so Shashank, what happens in EB simplex? What is the level of cleft in EB simplex? Is it subepidermal? Please remember, in EB simplex, you see intraepidermal cleft. So this is again a point which favors towards the diagnosis of EB simplex. And in EB simplex, you have congenital deficiency of keratin 5 and 14. And what is the role of keratin? It helps in the assembly, or it helps in the arrangement or a proper shape of the cell. So keratin filament assembly is defective in a patient of EB simplex because it affects keratin 5, 14. Please give me a quick thumbs up if you understood this very, very important question. And not a straightforward, little tricky question. Please give me a thumbs up. Anybody with any confusion here? Anyone with any confusion? Should I go ahead? So this is a case of mechanobullous disorder, EB simplex. Amazing. Let's go to the next question. And the next question is here on your computer screen. You have to tell me the correct answer. 45 seconds on your screen. 53-year-old woman comes to the clinic due to the skin rash. For the last 3 weeks, she has had a pruritic rash of worsening severity involving the posterior thigh. Patient recently began an exercise program to lose the weight and has been applying a topical anesthetic cream to her thighs, buttock after her workout. Physical examination shows a rash with blisters, ulcers, weeping, grinning lesions on the posterior thigh with the image shown. Which of the following is the most likely diagnosis or most likely skin biopsy finding in this particular patient? Now, I want all of you to please concentrate. Can you tell me what is seen here? Anybody can tell me the skin changes which is seen? You can see erythema. Obviously, it is visible. You can see that the lesion is slightly edematous. So erythema, edema, along with that, they have mentioned that you have weeping ulcers. So you have oozing. And if you remember, oozing is also known as eczema. So this is a classical case of acute eczema. And in acute eczema, the histopathological feature is spongiosis. What is spongiosis? It is an intercellular edema. For example, this is the cells of stratum spinosum, and you have accumulation of the fluid in between them like this. So spongiosis is a feature of acute eczema where you have intercellular edema. Please give me a thumbs up if you all have understood till here. Please give me a quick thumbs up if everybody have understood. Very, very important. 53-year-old woman who presented to the clinic with skin rash, a classical acute eczema, and when you do a biopsy, you will see presence of spongiosis. Fine. Let's move to the next question. Ready, all of you? The next question is on your computer screen. 45 seconds. On examination of a 45-year-old male, there were pink papules distributed symmetrically on the anterior surface of the shin, ankles. The biopsy reveals prominent hyperkeratosis along with thickened granular layer. There is a bend-like infiltrate of mononuclear cell. The retained ridges has sharpened and a sawtooth appearance, and the basal layer of epidermis is degenerated. Which of the following is the most likely diagnosis? atopic dermatitis, erythema nodosum, lichen planus or psoriasis? Please tell me the answer for this condition. Very nice, Manish, Etinolol, Yogesh, Dr. Baby, Shashank, Shruti, Riya, Fatima, Mani. I think everybody is right. Krishna, Dr. Grace, it's a very easy question. They have given you a classical histopathology with sawtoothing of the retinal ridges, colloid body, and along with that, you have a bent-shaped infiltrate. In a patient with pink papule or red papule present on the flexural area, classical feature of lichen planus. Now, can you tell me what is the treatment of choice for lichen planus? Anyone? What is the treatment of choice for lichen planus? Anyone can tell me the answer. Very nice. Please remember the treatment of choice for lichen planus is steroids. But can you tell me what form of steroids? Oral steroids, topical steroids, or intralesional steroids? Anyone? You all are right. The diagnosis is, or the answer is, steroids. But what type of steroids we are talking about? Please remember, we are talking about topical steroids. So topical steroids becomes the mainstay or treatment of choice in a patient of lichen planus. Okay, I think there is no confusion with this. You can give tacrolimus, Santosh. There are a lot of other options. For example, you can give phototherapy in the form of PUA, or you can give oral sorolin along with narrowband UVB therapy. You can also give the intralesional steroids if you have hypertrophic lesion. But if they ask you only the treatment of choice and one of the options is topical steroid, please mark that as your first choice. Clear? Please give me a thumbs up, Sonia, Santosh, all of you, KP, Ria, Tulika, please give me a thumbs up if this question is clear. Amazing. Let's move to the next question. Oh, I hope everyone is ready for the next question. Chalo. So this we have discussed recently only, and I am expecting a lot of you to answer this one. We have discussed this similar question few days back. So anybody can remember it and tell me. Praveen, Swat, Srinath, Manish, very nice. Dr. Madhu, Meghna, Tashneem, Dr. Grace, Shabana, Dr. Jasmine, Raj, Shashank, Dr. Mayank. UV or PUVA? Dr. Baby, your question is incorrect. UV means ultraviolet radiation. So in PUVA also you're using UVA only, right? So what are you talking about? Are you talking about the comparison of narrowband UVB with that of UVA therapy? Or you're asking something else? So please remember, both have their separate, or both have their plus and minus effect. Now, it is very difficult to ask a patient to, for example, I'm giving you a simple example. Now, if you come to me, or if anybody who is working come to me and ask me the treatment, and I have to give phototherapy, but what I will tell the patient, I will ask the patient to expose the body to the sun, or expose the lesion to the sun after, say, 2 hours or 3 hours. First of all, it is impractical. If you're working, you cannot fix a time for exposing your lesion. First point. Second point is, it depends upon the environmental condition. Now, for example, if you're talking about rainy season, will you see the UVA, the sunlight? Obviously, the answer is no. That is why we have NB-UVB therapy, a more preferred modality compared with that of the PUVA therapy, where we are using sunlight as one of the modality for giving the UVA radiations. Understood, Shashank, Dr. Baby, Tasneem, please give me a thumbs up. So if it is not planned and if you have to advise, you will ask the patient to take a drug and to visit after 2 hours in your clinic, and you can expose the patient to NB-UVB machines. And one more thing I want to add up here is, nowadays we also get UVA chambers. So that is why both are considered to be equal, because UVA, UVB chambers, both are available in the market. Now, this is a particular question from Dermatitis herpetiformis, and I think Shashank and Tashneem have already written it. So, if a patient presents to you with rash, itchy rash on the elbows and knee, which is associated with diarrhea, and when you do a biopsy, you will expect intralesional or intestinal intraepithelial lymphocyte, which is because of underlying celiac disease. Clear all of you? It is because of underlying celiac disease. And I think we have discussed this question recently. Now let's show you the histopath. You can see that this is the dermal papilla. You can see there's a white area. This is the cleft. You have fluid accumulated. And can you see in this fluid, you have a lot of inflammatory cells. In this fluid, you have a lot of inflammatory cells. So please remember, this is a very, very important point. I wanted everyone to just have a look over it, that this is a dermal papilla. This is a DIF finding where you can see that immunofluorescence is only present over the dermal tip. It is not seen over the retail. Only over the dermal tip, you have IgA deposits. And this type of appearance is known as picket fence appearance. Picket fence appearance, also known as granular IgA deposits. Understood or not? Please give me a thumbs up if you all have understood this point easy and clear. So this is our dermal papillary tip microabscess look like. Fine. And this is how the clinical appearance of DH look like. You have grouped vesicles which soon get ruptured to form erosions. Can you see these grouped erosions present here and there? Very, very classical of dermatitis herpetiformis. Coming to the next question. A 34-year-old female presented with a small bluish lesion under the nail of the left index finger. And again, we have discussed this question, so I'm not going much in detail. Can you tell me what is the answer here? Anyone can tell me the answer. Amazing. So the correct answer in this particular question is, So the correct answer in this question is option number 3. And can you tell me what is the diagnosis here? What is the diagnosis? It is the glomus tumor. We have already discussed this, and that is why I don't want to discuss it again. Quickly move to the next question. Can you tell me the answer for this question? Anyone can tell me the answer for this question? A 32-year-old woman who comes to the office because of worry that she will go bald. Her father has a receding hairline with apical baldness. Again, we have discussed this question. Please remember, this is a classical case of androgenic alopecia. And please remember, androgenic alopecia, it is a polygenic condition. Androgenic alopecia is a polygenic condition. There is not one factor. It does not follow the Mendelian mode of inheritance. You will see the spread from one person to another with multiple factors. For example, the environmental factors, the genetic background. You can even have the autoimmune background to develop these type of lesions in the patient. Clear, all of you? So I think these two questions were discussed very, very recently, and that is why I don't want to spend more time. Can you tell me what is the answer here? 30 seconds on your screen. 24-year-old men come to the physician for evaluation of severely pruritic rash. Physical examination shows symmetrical rash over the knees and elbow. Very nice. Yogesh, Manish, Swat, Shashank. Correct answer. We have just now discussed presence of IgA at the dermal papillary tip on immunofluorescence with microabscess. Can you tell me which cell is seen in a maximum concentration in this abscess? Which inflammatory cell is present in a highest concentration? The answer is neutrophils. The answer is neutrophils followed by eosinophils, followed by eosinophils. Theek hai ji? So please remember this question, very important. In eosinophil is maximum in which condition? In which vesiculobullous disorder you will see eosinophils in the bullous fluid? Can you answer this one? Yes, the answer is bullous pemphigoid. So please remember these questions. And as this is a case of DH, you will have gliadin-dependent lesions or gliadin-dependent disease, which you will see it here. Fine. Should I go to the next question, all of you? Please give me a thumbs up if everyone is ready for the next question. Amazing. The next question is here on your screen. Again, I think day before yesterday only we have discussed this question. Very easy, very, very easy. Fine. So this is a case of pyoderma gangrenosum. Now, why I have kept this question here? Because please remember, neutrophilic dermatosis, the one which is very, very commonly asked are three. One is Sweet syndrome. Sweet syndrome, you will have erythematous red lesions. It can be papule, it can be plaque, which is associated with high fever, and the common site is upper trunk or face. It can be associated with underlying malignancy. Can you tell me which is the commonest malignancy associated with Sweet syndrome? Anyone? Very nice. It is associated with blood malignancies like AML, ALL. It can be seen secondary to infections like streptococcal, staphylococcal infections. And third, it can be seen secondary to drugs, for example, G-CSF or GM-CSF. So these three are the causes of Sweet syndrome. Rest, everything is common in other neutrophilic dermatosis, that when you take a biopsy from the lesion, you will see a lot of neutrophils. When you do a pathology test, it tells you the hypersensitive skin. Okay, clear? So Sweet syndrome, another point is it is associated with pseudovesicles. Very commonly asked in your exam. Where do you see pseudovesiculation? So the answer is Sweet syndrome. Second is pyoderma gangrenosum. The most common association is with inflammatory bowel disease, that is ulcerative colitis followed by Crohn's disease. Ulcerative colitis followed by Crohn's disease. What are the other features? Can you tell me what are the other features of pyoderma gangrenosum? Rapidly progressive ulcer. When you take a pus culture sensitivity, you will see presence of sterile lesion. There's no bacteria taking place. So it is a sterile condition, absolutely sterile. And if it is sterile, there's no point of giving any antibiotic. You just need to give steroids or you can combine it with Depson. Please remember, it will heal with cribriform scar. This also we have discussed. And here also you will have pathology test positive. Srinath, pathology test is positive in all the type of neutrophilic dermatosis. What is the pathology test signifies? It tells you that the skin is hypersensitive. Now, what do you do in a patient of pathology test, or how do you perform a pathology test? You will just give a prick to the patient's skin, or you can inject normal saline. Now, by simple pricking, there will be exaggerated response and you will see development of a papule within 24 to 48 hours of the prick. So that is how it tells you that the skin is hypersensitive. Lastly comes with the Behçet's disease, which is sometimes known as orogenital syndrome. You have aphthous ulcer in the oral cavity, genital cavity. You will have lesions in the eyes in the form of uveitis. You will have joint pain and you will have skin features like presence of folliculitis, erythema nodosum. Sometimes superficial thrombophlebitis can be seen. giving rise to CNS manifestation if the dural venous sinuses gets affected. So please remember, these three questions are asked very frequently, and that is why I thought of discussing it more in detail. With this, we are done with today's session. I request all my dear students to please subscribe to an academy using a 1 month referral code and use my code, that is Cheshta10, so that you get additional 10% discount on the subscription. So bye bye all of you. Take care and good day.